Good morning, Central Church, and welcome to our worship service online for April 19th, 2020. I want to welcome you all today as we join in this worship service together. And I want to challenge you for something new we're going to try next week. If you will take photos or videos of your children or pets or those who are in your household watching our service, and if you would, please send those to hannah@arcentralchurch.org. So be on the lookout for really cute instances happening during worship today from those in your house watching. I'm going to start off by reading Romans 12, verse 2. Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewal of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. During this time, it's really important that we make the choice to have a sound mind and to interrupt our thoughts from negative to positive and thoughts about Christ. And one of my mentors told me today, we may be socially distant, but we are not spiritually disconnected. So here's your opportunity this morning to get plugged in and connected to Central. We hope you enjoy service.
Good morning, Central Church family. Hope you guys are having a good morning. We are so glad we get to congregate with you guys online. Although we can't see you guys in person, we send our love to each and every one of you guys. We just wanted to say good morning.
Good morning. So today I'm going to read Psalm 23, verse 1 through 6. The Lord is my shepherd, I lack nothing. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He refreshes my soul. He guides me along the right paths for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup overflows. Surely your goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life. And I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Say bye.
Bye.
Good morning, Central family. We're coming to you this morning from the Mystikian Hog House. We'd like to read a passage to you this morning from 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 2 through 11.
Grace and peace be yours in abundance through the knowledge of God and of Jesus our Lord. His divine power has given us everything we need for a godly life through our knowledge of Him who called us by His own glory and goodness. Through these, He has given us His very great and precious promises, so that through them you may participate in the divine nature, having escaped the corruption of the world caused by evil desires.
For this very reason, make every effort to add to your faith goodness, and to goodness knowledge, and to knowledge self-control, and to self-control perseverance, and to perseverance godliness, and to godliness mutual affection, and to mutual affection love. For if you possess these qualities in increasing measure, they will keep you from being ineffective and unproductive in your knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. But whoever does not have them is nearsighted and blind, forgetting that they have been cleansed from their past sins.
10. Therefore, my brothers and sisters, make every effort to confirm your calling and election. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. 11. And you will receive a rich welcome into the eternal kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
We hope everybody has a great day, and we hope to see you soon.
Good morning, Central family, visitors and guests. We are the Hampton family. We appreciate the opportunity to connect with you this morning. We know how important connections are, especially in a time like this. Thank you so much for having us in your home.
Well, our family's going to be reading from Ephesians 3:14-21. For this reason I kneel before the Father, from whoever family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray out his glorious riches and may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love,
may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all fullness of God. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we may ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Thank you for allowing us to come into your home today and share Christ.
Begin our time together in song. I will call upon the Lord, for who is worthy to be praised? And so shall I be saved from my enemy. You know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock. Let God of my salvation be exalted. You know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock. Let God of my salvation be exalted. Jesus Christ died for me, and he took away my sin, and I will live with him for eternity. Yes, you know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock. Let God of my salvation be exalted. You know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock. Let God of my salvation be exalted. You know the Lord liveth, blessed be the rock. Let God of my salvation be exalted. You know the Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock. Let God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, and how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. And I heard about his glory, of his precious blood atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory.
Yeah. Good morning, family. When we share in communion together, we are remembering Christ's death on the cross that was for our sins. The bread is his body, and the wine is his blood.
1 Corinthians 11:23-26 says, "For I pass on to you what I received from the Lord himself. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord Jesus took some bread and gave thanks to God for it. Then he broke it in pieces and said, 'This is my body, which is given for you. Do this to remember me.' In the same way, he took the cup of wine after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant between God and his people, an agreement confirmed with my blood. Do this to remember me as often as you drink it. For every time you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are announcing the Lord's death until he comes again.'"
Not only are we announcing the Lord's death, but we're announcing his resurrection. The resurrection that brings us hope of eternal life and forgiveness of our sin. Please join us in prayer for the bread.
Dear God, thank you for today, and thank you for the blessings that you've given us. And I pray that you will bless this bread that we're about to eat, and I pray that it will help us remember you, and I pray that it will help us spread your word throughout the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's pray for the cup. Dear God, thank you for this day. Thank you for everything you've given us. And thank you for letting us take this cup to remember Christ's blood as he died for us. And please help us to still be thinking of each other even though we can't actually have church with each other. And thank you for always providing for us. And it's in your son's name we pray, amen.
Amen.
Wonderful, merciful Savior, precious Redeemer and friend. Who would have thought that a lamb could rescue the souls of men? Oh, you rescue the souls of men. Counselor, Comforter, Keeper, Spirit, we long to embrace. You offer hope in our hearts, hopelessly lost away. And oh, we hopelessly lost away. You are the one that we pray. You are the one that we pray.
Hey, Central Family. We're going through some strange times, and I can't tell you how much I miss seeing you all. We were not made to be isolated. The church was not made to be isolated. In fact, Paul even writes about this in his letter to the Corinthians when he refers to the church as being formed into one body. He says, "The eye can't say to the hand, 'I don't need you.' The head can't say to the feet, 'I don't need you.' In fact, it is just the opposite. The parts of the body that seem to be weaker are the ones we can't do without. The parts that we think are less important, we treat with special honor. The private parts aren't shown, but they are treated with special care. The parts that can be shown don't need special care. But God has put together all the parts of the body, and He has given more honor to the parts that didn't have any. In that way, the parts of the body will not take sides. All of them will take care of one another. If one part suffers, every part suffers with it. If one part is honored, every part shares in its joy. You are the body of Christ. Each one of you is a part of it." You know, we're going through some pretty turbulent times right now, and for some of our family, it's going to get much worse before it gets better. But I've been able to see firsthand how this church family bands together and helps each other through hard times. Our elders and staff are trying to stay in tune with everyone's needs during this time, and I pray that if you're struggling right now, reach out to one of our staff members or elders. If you're being called to give in abundance of your normal giving to help those that may be in need, I ask that you do, and that God opens doors for you to find those opportunities. As always, you can give via PushPay or Cash App, or if you still like to lick envelopes and put stamps on envelopes, then you can send those checks to Hannah. Again, I love you all. I miss you guys greatly.
I know that my Redeemer lives and ever prays for me. And I know eternal life He kept from sin and sorrow free. And I know that my Redeemer lives. I know eternal life He gives. I know. And He wills that I should wholly be in word and thought indeed. And then I His holy face may see when from this earth life freed. And I know that my Redeemer lives. And I know eternal life He sings. And I know that my Redeemer lives. Yes, and I know eternal life He gives. Sing, I know that my Redeemer lives, that my Redeemer lives.
Hello. Today I'll be reading from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. Again, that is Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. In the first book of Theophilus, I have dealt with all that Jesus began to do and teach, to the day when He was taken up after He had given commandments through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom He had chosen. He presented Himself alive to them after His suffering by many proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. And while staying with them, He ordered them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which He had said, "You heard from me, for John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now." So when they had come together, they asked him, "Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom to Israel?" He said to them, "It is not for you to know times or seasons that the Father has fixed by his own authority. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witness in Jerusalem, in all of Judea and Samaria, and to the end of the earth." When he had said these things, as they were looking on, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. And while they were gazing into heaven as he went, behold, two men stood by them in white robes and said, "Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking into heaven? This Jesus, who is taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven."
Good morning, Central Church family. It's good to be with you again. Leon is still feeling under the weather and is hoping to get some test results back from the doctors soon so that he can have some solutions to his health problems. But it's good to be with you today in his place and to go ahead and share the message that he wanted to share with us this morning from Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11. It's really a great passage of scripture. Jesus has been raised from the dead and has been interacting with his disciples for 40 days, telling them lots of things, answering probably lots of questions. And he gives them instruction. "I want you to go and stay in Jerusalem and wait until the Holy Spirit comes, and then you're going to have something to do." And their response to him is to begin asking him questions. "Oh, well, are you going to do what we think you're going to do? Are you going to return the kingdom of Israel back to what we thought you were going to do with it?" And other things like that. And Jesus says back to them, "Hey, it's not for you to worry about what you think is going to happen or what you would like to happen. That's for God to know. What you need to do is just go do what I ask you to do, which is go wait in Jerusalem for the Holy Spirit to come and show you the next things that I would like for you to do." And while they were standing there, Jesus was taken up into heaven, or the ascension as we call it sometimes. And they stand there looking and watching and wondering what's going on. And then some angels show up and say, "Why are you waiting around watching in the skies? He's going to come back in the same way he left. And it's time for you all to get busy. Go do what he said to do." And so Jesus' disciples were distracted by their own ideas, their own assumptions, what they thought Jesus might do next. We're like that sometimes. We get distracted by our own ideas or assumptions about the way things are supposed to be. And sometimes our assumptions and our ideas can help us not see the thing that we should be seeing. I remember the first time I went on an organized deer hunt with some of my relatives. I've never been hunting with a group before. I'd always hunted on my own and never saw a deer in the woods. This time my uncles took me out and they dropped me off in what we would call a holler in North Arkansas, kind of a valley. And they said, "We want you to walk in the bottom of the valley and we want you to walk up toward where we're going to be. And you will chase the deer toward us and we'll be able to shoot them. And if you see a deer along the way, you can take a shot at it as well." Well, I've never seen a deer in the woods before. I wasn't sure what to expect. And so I've walked very quietly for probably almost a half hour in really cold temperatures, keeping my eye peeled for a deer. And I come up on a big pile of logs kind of laid over in the woods, probably 25 yards in front of me or so. And as I get closer, suddenly a deer just takes off, running away from me, directly the opposite direction. And I could see, as he was leaving behind, he probably was one of those 8-point bucks, really big ones, running away in the other direction. I don't know what I was thinking. I didn't see him at all. He saw me and took off running. I think perhaps I was expecting that they would kind of stand up and turn to the side and wait for you to shoot them, like give you 10 seconds. Didn't do that though, because I had in my mind this weird picture of how it would be easy to shoot a deer and how they would just kind of stand up and wait for you. I didn't see it, and it took off before I had a chance to do anything. And by the time it was probably a quarter mile away from me, I took a shot, which obviously didn't hit anything. Sometimes our assumptions, our distractions of our own ideas about the way things should be, keep us from seeing the very thing that we should see and the thing that we should do. That's kind of the human condition. Let me give you another example to think about. In this video that you're getting ready to watch here in a moment, there's a guy and it's raining outside and he's going to run from the front porch across the yard and to a car that's going to pick him up. And as you're watching this video, you see that he's holding up his shorts so as not to get them any wetter. And as he runs across the yard, he seems to forget about the fact that there is a ditch between the yard and the road where the car is waiting. And he just keeps on going because he's so distracted by about not getting wet that he forgets that the ditch is there. And he didn't just get his shorts a little wet, all of them falls into the water. Have you ever been distracted? Has your distraction ever kept you from seeing the obvious that's in front of you, the good things that are to be done in front of you, or maybe the bad things that you should avoid? It's important to think about how we think. Sometimes our assumptions, our ideas about the way we think things should be, keep us from seeing some things that are pretty obvious. Jesus' disciples, even though they had walked with him for a long time, and they'd gone through the death, the burial, and the resurrection, and then spent 40 days with him, they still had a lot of assumptions about what he was going to do, what he wasn't going to do, what they were going to do. And Jesus said, I want you to go wait for the Holy Spirit to come, and he's going to show you what to do. So we're in pretty good company. If Jesus' disciples themselves had trouble focusing and listening to what Jesus was asking them to do instead of getting distracted by their own assumptions about what they thought he was going to do, we're in good company. It's good for us, just like them, to have Jesus clear the air and remind us of what it is that he wants rather than just thinking about what we want. And maybe it's not just what we want. Sometimes maybe it's what we think God wants. Sometimes we're willing to fill in the blanks and say, this is probably what he wants us to do. Over in James chapter 4, James says some very important things I want us to hear. He says, now listen, you who say, today or tomorrow, we will go to this or that city and spend a year there, carry on business and make money. Why, you don't even know what will happen tomorrow. What is your life? You're a mist that appears for a little while and then vanishes. Instead, you ought to say, if it's the Lord's will, we will live and do this or that. As it is, you boast in your arrogant schemes, and all such boasting is evil. If anyone then knows the good that they ought to do and don't do it, it's sin for them. James reminds us that we can get so caught up in our assumptions that we want to lay on top of the Lord or the Lord's plan for us or the Lord's plan for anybody, that we can get blinded to the very things that are around us to do. And he says, what's wrong with this is you get so caught up in your plans that you don't even see the people and the situations that are right around you all the time that he wants you to do. It's kind of like those times where you wake up late on a Sunday morning and everyone is in a hurry and everyone gets on everybody's nerves and no one is cooperating and his shoes aren't getting put on feet as fast as they should be, and breakfast isn't eaten, clothes have to be ironed, and everyone is yelling at each other in the car, and then you finally pull up to the church building to worship God and encourage each other, and you go from being angry to, or good morning, brother or sister. We get so caught up and distracted about not wanting to be late to church where we worship God and encourage each other that we totally forget that you are supposed to love each other outside of church, on the way to church. It's a totally different way of seeing things. It's taking away our assumptions about what God wants us to do and just saying all the time, tell us what we need to do and let's go do it. Let me give another example to think about. Let's say that we as a church get together and decide to pick a ministry that we all want to do and we get really into it. And it's a service kind of ministry where we go to a certain place. We invest time and money and energy into it. And so we're ready for it and we begin doing it. And we're pretty good at it. We get a lot of our members involved. But as the weeks go by, we realize that this great project that we're doing for God, that we want God to bless, is actually taking us away from reaching out to our own family or reaching out to the people in our own neighborhood, or the people that we work with, or anybody else that puts in God's path, that we've tied up all of our resources in this one thing, but all those resources of time and money and whatever else are being pulled away from the very people that God has around us right now to start with. Another thing that should stand out to us is we don't know the future. Who would have guessed that we would be where we are now with this pandemic, with this virus, and the reaction that our country and the world has had? Things happen. Have you ever been punched in the face? I mean, like, really gobsmacked right upside the head. If you've never been hit before, the first time you get hit, it's kind of disconcerting. You kind of lose focus of reality for a moment or two. You're not quite sure what to do. People who are experienced in boxing or fighting get used to getting hit, kicked, knocked around a little bit occasionally. It takes a while. Times like this make me think about the future ahead. We don't know what's going to hit us next. And when we are hit, what kind of fight are we as Christians ready for? I don't mean a physical fight or getting hit in the head. But what is it that hits us as believers or as a church that stops us dead in our tracks? How long does it take us to get back on our feet and figure out, oh, I'm still a believer, I just got hit by something really hard? Or, oh, we're still a church, we just hit a brand new thing we've never been hit with before. I'm not suggesting that we go out looking for fights by any means, but it is important for us to think through, what does it take to knock us off of our feet? And when all of this is over, or at least at a different place, what should we do going forward to train ourselves or to let God train us and shape us for things like this? Maybe it's times like this that remind us of the things that we should be focusing on to start with all the time. The things that are around us, the people, the situations, the blessings that we have. And sometimes the opportunities that are all around us all the time. If you've ever been around horses at all, you'll notice that sometimes people who own horses will put blinders on horses where they can't see to their side. And this is to keep the horses focused in on just a few things in front of them. They can't see the horse to their right or to their left or other things that distract them. All they can see is the road ahead of them. I think sometimes the Lord asks us to take off some of our blinders, some of our assumptions, the things that keep us focused in on just a few things that we see, that we think he wants us to do or not do. So, some takeaways from this story here in Acts chapter 1, verses 1 through 11, where Jesus' disciples have a lot of assumptions about what he's going to do next now that he's raised from the dead and what he tells them actually to do. The first thing that we need to see that we need to do as a takeaway is we need to listen to the Lord a lot more and not just say the things that we think he says for us to do. That doesn't mean just listening to the scripture or just reading the Bible, which we should do all the time, but also day to day, wherever we are, in whatever situation we're in, with whoever we're with, we're asking the Lord, what should I do in this situation? Should I say something? Should I do something that will benefit them, that will serve them, that will let them experience the love that I have felt from you, Lord, so that they can see that through my actions and through my words? That's the first thing we should do, is just listen to the Lord, both in his word and also in everyday situations. Listen to the Spirit reminding us of what we need to hear and do. Secondly, we need to do what he says. Lots of times we get prompted by the Spirit, a moment where we feel like God maybe is saying something, or we're remembering something, and we feel the need to go do something about that. Go do it. Just go do it. Just like Jesus says to the disciples, it's not for you to decide what's going to happen next. God knows what's going to happen next. But for you, you listen to me, go to Jerusalem, wait for the Holy Spirit, and he's going to show you what to do next. For all of us this week, listen to the Lord and do what he says in every situation that you're in. I can promise you that if you do that this week, if you listen to God through his word and through the Spirit, in each moment that you're cooped up in the house with your family, with your spouse, your kids, or maybe still going to work, that you ask him, Lord, what is it you want me to do? He will show you something to do, and he will show you who to talk to, what you can do. Maybe you won't know in the moment how that's going to turn out, but at least you're listening to the Lord and you're doing what he asks you to do. I want to challenge you this week, instead of just listening to this and going away, if you would, when that moment or those moments happen in your life, if you would come back to this video and post somewhere below what it was God showed you, the moment he moved in your heart and showed you someone to talk to, someone to pray with, some way to serve, and share that with the body so that everyone else can see this really does work. I pray that this week the Lord blesses you and keeps you. Let's bow together in prayer as we wrap this up. Father, we want to thank you for the writing the word that you've written for us, that you show us so many things through stories, through people, especially through Acts chapter 1, where the disciples had spent so much time with Jesus and they were still assuming that he was going to do some things that they wanted him to do, or they assumed he was going to do. But Lord, that he pointed them to next steps and wanted them to, by faith, just go and wait and do what he showed them to do. Father, I ask that you would bless us this week. Help us to be your hands and your feet, whether we're stuck at home because of this virus, or we're out at work, or wherever we are, that we're listening to your Spirit speak to us and show us things, show us people, show us situations where we can love and serve and let people see and experience the love that you've shown us through what we say and do. Lord, we ask you this in Jesus' name. Amen. Have a blessed week, everyone.
You are my strength when I am weak. You are the treasure that I see. You are my all in all. And seeking you as a precious jewel, love to give up, I'd be a fool. You are my all in all. Jesus, taking my sin, my cross, my shame, rising again, I bless your name. You are my all in all. Jesus, when I fall down, you pick me up. When I am dry, you fill my cup. You are my all in all. Amen.
A reminder that this is the year of hope, and so we have a couple of things that we're hopeful for.
I hope to be with my fourth and fifth graders in Bible class again.
And I hope for the time before and after worship in the lobby where we may get the choice to enforce social distancing.
I'll be reading from Numbers chapter 6, verse 24 through 26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
And I'll be reading from Psalm 62. For God alone, O my soul, wait in silence, for my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in him at all times, O people. Pour out your heart before him. God is a refuge for us all. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for today. We thank you for getting us through this last week. And Father, we pray your encouragement and your strength through this next week. Help us to stay strong. Help us to be healthy and safe. Father, I pray that we can be contagious, that we can spread your love and your hope and your strength, and just help us to be more patient. Help us to have more love and more peace. And Father, just be with us as we try to continue to be more like your Son. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.